Jana Marie, thank you for speaking with us.
I'm delighted to be here.
So it was 20 years ago that this facility opened, and it's known everywhere as a trendsetter in ballpark design. Talk a little about the trends that Oriole Park at Camden Yards set.
Well, this was the first park in two generations to move into an urban setting and say we want to be a part of downtown. And so the combination of Governor William Donald Schaefer picking this site here on the edge of the Inner Harbor and Larry Lucchino, the Orioles president, wanting it to be a baseball-only, old-fashioned park that harkened back to the days of Ebbets and Forbes and Fenway, just gave us a great alignment of the stars and gave us a reason to do something different.
Talk a little about the pride that you must feel having been involved in the team that designed it and looking out, the place has aged great, better than I have, no question.
Well, give credit for that to the Maryland Stadium Authority, who owns and maintains the place, and to Peter Angelos, who's just done an outstanding job during his tenure of owning the Orioles of keeping it fresh and new.
When it's time to think about renovations and upgrades, what were your goals going into this project?
Well, we wanted to make sure that we kept pace with the times as much as anything. And Peter Angelos has always said, look, it's great to get rave reviews when we open. How do we continue to get rave reviews? And like any 20-year-old facility, we needed a new roof, we needed new concrete toppings, we needed something different for our fans to do. So this combination of projects that debuted our 20th season of the roof deck here in the outfield, the sculptures dedicated to the players whose numbers we retired, and giving a renewed life to the flag court were just kind of obvious things to do as we followed along in the sidecar of the Maryland Stadium Authority. And they focused this year on the restoration of the warehouse, so we focused on Utah Street.
As we're standing here, it's not a game day, but you have people in the ballpark looking at the stadium, getting a tour. That must make you feel pretty good.
Oh, absolutely. And that's what we wanted when we moved into the Inner Harbor, is to be a part of the total West Side Renaissance. And so having these guided tours, having several hundred fans wandering up and down Utah Street was very much part of the goal of not shuttering the gates when there's not a game, but being a part of downtown life.
Well, let's focus in on some of the new amenities. We're standing in an area that has been here in center field, but has just been occupied by camera crews to this point.
That's right. The roof deck was always the best center field camera position in baseball. We heard that from every other team. And we thought, golly, if it's good enough for our cameras, why not let our fans up here? And again, in sticking with the theme, the Maryland Stadium Authority needed to repair this roof. And so we said, okay, great. Let's put that money into something that's more interesting and adds new life to the park. And Peter Angelos had always wanted to do something very casual, like you see in other outfield settings like the Chop House in Atlanta. So we designed this area that has two rows of seating, both stools and standing room area. And then we also wanted to do just kind of a, you know, porch lounge type seating. And my favorite thing about this is that not only do you have this great view of the game, but you're also overlooking the bullpens, you're overlooking the new bronze sculptures that will be debuting this year, and you even got a people watching spot to look over Utah Street.
What do you charge for these seats? This is pretty good out here.
We don't charge anything extra. Any game ticket will get you up here, and that's the fun of it. People can have great field box seats. We'll come in early and take in an inning or two, or maybe batting practice, and then move on to their seats. And other people will buy a standing room ticket and come up here and spend the entire game. So we've just treated it first come, first serve, and we'll see how our fans react.
Do you expect in future years this might be a premium area, a party spot?
You know, I wouldn't say so. It's always going to be an outfield seat. There are always going to be 9 out of 10 fans that would rather be watching from the infield area. So I think it's just a great, fun spot, a casual place. And a lot of times you find people want to take in the game different ways. You know, sometimes maybe you want to come and the pitcher's holding your interest, and other times it's just the atmosphere.
So you expect a lot of circulation through this area?
We do. We've seen a lot of fans will come up here and spend an inning or two and then move on to their seats, and we'll see how it plays out over the course of the season.
A lot of people are familiar with Boog's Barbecue, has been around forever, but you have some new amenities out on Utah Street as well.
We do. Rick Dempsey is opening a restaurant that'll be open year-round, day in and day out. Hopefully we'll be open for lunch as well. We have a little market on Utah Street that's open every day. And Stuggies and Gino's are right here at the north end of Utah Street greeting you as you come into Camden Yards.
Janet, as part of the renovations, the ballpark looks the same until you look really closely, and then there's a change in the seating capacity. What was the rationale for that?
Well, when we opened in 1992, we had 48,800 seats. Now, against the backdrop of Memorial Stadium, which had 55,000 seats, that seems small. But the trend in baseball has been smaller and smaller and smaller as multi-purpose venues have gone by the wayside. Miami just opened their new park for the Marlins with only 38,000 seats. Last year, PNC reported 39,000 seats. Fenway just did a $300 million renovation, 38,000 seats. So we felt big compared to other parks. When the Maryland Stadium Authority redid the concrete a year ago on the club level and upper deck and bought new chairs, instead of buying the same one-for-one chair, we just bought wider chairs. And thus our seating capacity decreased. We went down to about 46,000 seats. Our fans actually have a more comfortable chair. And we took the savings by buying fewer chairs and redid the railings so that we have a nicer sight line through those railings to the field. Then this year, we've taken some of these areas in the outfield, which were always sort of a hallmark of Camden Yards to have the standing room, and just dial those up a little bit and tried to make the standing room even more inviting and have better views, lowered the railing on the flag court, added the seating up here in center field, and redid some of the standing room in the sculpture garden.
Is there anything you can do about getting rid of the seats that the Red Sox fans occupy?
We can displace them with Oriole fans, and that's our goal.
That's a good plan. Do you think the renovations on the whole will bring more people back to the ballpark?
Well, I do think there are a lot of fans that will look at the energy here and say, golly, that looks like fun. I'd like to go down there. So sure, we hope that it will. But mostly what we want to do is make certain that Camden Yards doesn't age, that it always has a timeless quality to it. That was the goal 20 years ago. And Peter Angelos has maintained that goal here in 2012. We don't mind having Red Sox and Yankee fans here. That was the part of Schaefer's plan in being downtown, is that we would be a part of the destination for those who come and view the Inner Harbor as a tourist spot.
Is there anything, rolling back the clock 20 years to when you were involved in the design of this, that knowing now what you didn't know then in terms of how stadium design has evolved, that you would have done differently? I know it was a key decision to keep the warehouse, which has become an icon. Is there anything you wish you had done differently 20 years ago?
Oh, that's a tough question. I'm not sure if my rearview mirror is any better than my crystal ball. I don't know. It feels very comfortable 20 years later.
This was in some ways a radical thing 20 years ago.
Yeah, it was, and yet we learned from the past by studying the older ballparks. We learned from studying the newer parks. We knew things we wanted and things we didn't. You know, I think some things that were left on the cutting room floor 21 years ago, like having a service level that covers the entirety of the concourse, are still things that from an operational perspective you'd love to have. But all in all, I think it's been a good home for the Orioles.
Well, thank you for speaking with us. Good luck to you in the stadium, and good luck to the Orioles this year.
Thank you.